I don't know if you have experienced the same thing when talking about the origins of our species with many people. I've always had the impression that most of them live their lives unaware of much of the past, almost convinced that humanity has always inhabited a world relatively peaceful and organized, like ours. In reality, as we know, this is not the case. We are fortunate enough not to have to worry about survival, since food, shelter, and safety are all taken for granted. But these things have not always been this way. Very few people realize that we are only a lucky minority, as much of human history took place in a very different world from the one we live in today. Our history did not begin during the times of Rome or the pyramids, as many believe, but rather in a time far more distant. Studies indicate that our evolutionary path began about 7 to 8 million years ago, with the separation from the branch of primates, and that Homo Habilis, the first member of Homo genus, appeared about 2.8 million years ago, distinguishing itself from other hominids for its stone tool making abilities. Then began a long, tormented, and adventurous journey. The great adventure began less than 2 million years ago, when some groups belonging to the Homo erectus species, descendants from Homo Habilis, left their territory in the Horn of Africa to migrate to vast areas of North Africa, Europe, and Asia. Since survival in the cold European forests required different qualities than those necessary to survive in the jungles of Indonesia, human populations evolved in different directions. The result was the production of many distinct species. While these early humans were evolving in Europe and Asia, evolution in East Africa did not stop. Numerous new species continued to emerge from the cradle of humanity, and finally, our own species, which we modestly named Homo sapiens, the intelligent man, the man who thinks. The members of some of these species were large-bodied, and others were dwarves. Some were tremendous hunters, and others were quiet plant-gatherers. Some lived and remained only on islands, while many others migrated across continents. But they all belonged to the Homo genus. They were all human beings. All of them planned for the future, buried their dead, and had their own cultures. However, despite this, different human species evolved differently, depending on the environment in which they lived. Some developed the ability to create sophisticated art and tools, while others remained limited to more rudimentary techniques. But above all, they all developed some form of language, perhaps a proto-language, less complex than ours. However, one by one, all the other species disappeared, the last one not more than 12,000 years ago, and we do not know the reasons for their extinction. The last remains of Homo soliensis date back to about 50,000 years ago. Homo denisova disappeared shortly thereafter. Neanderthals exited the stage approximately 30,000 years ago. The last humans, similar to gnomes from the island of Flores, disappeared about 12,000 years ago. They left behind some bones, some tools, a few genes belonging to our DNA, and an enormous amount of unanswered questions. And they all left us, the sapiens, alone. We do not know with certainty whether our human cousins disappeared due to competition for resources or as a result of a series of genocides. What is certain, however, is that we are the only human beings left on Earth. But if we look back in time to the origin of our species, we can understand how we came to be what we are today. Less than 3 million years ago, Homo habilis was already using stone tools. But despite this, in the 2 million years that followed, humans remained weak and marginal creatures. Despite their big brains and sharp flint tools, those remote predecessors continued to live in constant fear of predators, rarely able to hunt large game, and essentially lived off of gathered plants, picking insects, and eating the carrion of other animals. Until we learned to control fire. It is possible that some human species occasionally used fire as early as 800,000 years ago. But we know for sure that 300,000 years ago, Homo erectus, Neanderthals, and the ancestors of Homo sapiens were using fire daily. Humans could thus have a formidable source of light and heat, as well as a deadly weapon against predators. The best thing that could be done with fire, however, was to cook. Foods that humans could not digest in their natural form, such as wheat, rice, and potatoes, thus became the basis of their diet, thanks to cooking. Fire has not only changed the chemistry of food, but also biology, cooking meat killing the germs and parasites that infest the food. Moreover, once cooked, it was easier to chew and digest than the staple foods of before, such as fruits, nuts, insects, and even carrion. While chimpanzees spent 5 hours a day chewing their raw food, those who consumed cooked food only needed to chew for 1 hour. And according to some, the energy saved in the effort of chewing and digestion contributed to the evolution of a more performing brain, leading to the development of a more complex language. It was thanks to the use of fire that some human species started showing their muscle and hunting large game around 400,000 years ago, with Homo sapiens reaching the top of the food chain at least 100,000 years ago. This spectacular leap had enormous consequences. Other animals at the top of the pyramid, such as lions and sharks, had gradually climbed to that position over millions of years, allowing the ecosystem to develop filters and balances that prevented too much disruption. While lions became deadlier, gazelles learned to run faster, hyenas learned to cooperate better, and rhinos became more unapproachable. Humans, on the other hand, climbed to the top so quickly that the ecosystem did not have time to balance things out. Many historical calamities, such as deadly wars to ecological disasters, may be the result of this overly rapid leap. Despite the change in status and the acquired reputation of being bad and dangerous, it was only around 70,000 years ago that Homo sapiens began doing truly special things. Around that time, groups of sapiens left Africa for a second time after a first wave 30,000 years earlier had been repelled. This time, sapiens pushed Neanderthals and all other human species not only out of the Middle East, but off the face of the Earth. In a remarkably short period, sapiens reached Europe and East Asia. Around 45,000 years ago, they managed to cross an ocean and land in Australia, a continent previously uninhabited by humans. The period from 70,000 to around 30,000 years ago was an explosion of creativity and discoveries. Rafts and then boats to cross bodies of water, oil lamps, bows and arrows, and bone needles essential for sewing clothes that actually protected against the cold. From this extraordinary flowering of positive transformations, perhaps greater tranquility of life was born, and therefore the opportunity for sapiens to begin looking inside themselves. This soon led to a period of transcendence and artistic sense. Famous Paleolithic figurines, such as the so-called Venus figurines, as well as extraordinary cave paintings found throughout Europe, date back to this time. Even today, it is difficult to fully understand the meaning of these cave paintings, whose high quality initially left even the discoverers incredulous, reluctant to date them to such remote times. Some scholars believe that such splendid figurative scenes were used to explain how hunting took place. Others are convinced that prehistoric humans painted with the intention of understanding the order, shapes, rhythms, and forces of the reality that surround them, to know more deeply about the world in which they lived. The image was therefore a means of better understanding the environment. However, the most plausible hypothesis for us is that this art was linked to the mysterious phase of reconciliation rituals. In fact, the rock paintings are almost always found in truly unusual natural environments, frequented by many generations of hunters and created by men who were forced to paint in very uncomfortable positions and in the light of rudimentary torches. Those who went to such great lengths to decorate the walls of caves where no one habitually lived must have considered these paintings truly important. At that time, humans lived mostly by hunting in small groups, but 12,000 years ago, a process began that would change their way of life forever: the transition from hunting to agriculture. It is not easy to determine exactly when this happened. What is certain, however, is that humans learned to cultivate the land independently in different parts of the planet. It is also certain that the process of agricultural diffusion was very slow, so much so that the term agricultural revolution, used for many years in this context, is now being questioned But why did Homo sapiens, who had lived as hunters and gatherers for tens of thousands of years, become farmers? Scientists have proposed many different theories. Demographic hypotheses have been proposed, such as population growth and the consequent need for more food. Social theories, according to which the desire to display power and wealth would have necessitated the production of greater quantities of food. Even astronomical events, such as the possible impact of a meteorite, which would have reduced the available and potentially huntable fauna. Other theories link the development of agriculture to climate change. In fact, the discovery of agriculture took place at the end of the Ice Age, about 11,700 years ago. According to some scholars, the rise in temperature would have favored the birth and development of crops. According to another theory, the first forms of cultivation developed precisely because the cold had reduced forest resources for gathering. In any case, the agricultural revolution could probably not have been triggered by any single factor, but by the occurrence of several favorable and perhaps different conditions in a given geographical area compared to another. Therefore, all the hypotheses we have listed could be totally or partially valid. In the long run, the discovery of agriculture was an invaluable advance for humanity. But in the short run, not all of its effects were positive. In fact, it led to the spread of infectious diseases, as closer contact with animals allowed viruses and bacteria of animal origin to jump species and infect humans. Some scholars have also hypothesized that agriculture in the early days led to a worsening of the diet, because it was less varied and less rich in protein compared to that of hunting and gathering. But this hypothesis is debated. Despite these negative effects, the invention of agriculture is the basis for the birth of civilization. In fact, humans moved from nomadism to sedentism. While in a hunter-gatherer economy, it is necessary to move when the resources in an area are exhausted. When one cultivates the land, one becomes stationary because one has to wait for the crop to yield its fruits. This was the origin of the first permanent settlements and, over the centuries, the first cities, including Jericho in Palestine and Çatalhöyük in the Anatolian Peninsula. Agriculture has also made it possible to increase the amount of food available. 1 hectare of cultivated land yields up to 100 times more than 1 hectare of forest used for hunting and gathering. Therefore, cultivation allowed some men to be liberated from the search for food and to devote themselves to other activities. Thus, the division of labor was born. While the vast majority of men continued to gather or produce food, a minority could specialize in other occupations, such as making pottery and tools. Initially, the division was not clear, but gradually it allowed the creation of complex and developed societies. The ability to cultivate the land also entailed the beginning of a different relationship between humans and nature. Humans began to modify natural environments to suit their needs. In short, it is with agriculture that the evolution that produced human civilization as we know it today began. And also, unfortunately, the conflicts that followed in defense of territories with strictly defined boundaries. Was this for the good? Was it bad? That's for you to decide.